Hello, my dear students. I hope you all have been doing well. Today we are going to discuss about oxidative phosphorylation and electron transport chains, and it is a very interesting topic, and it is also interesting to me. So it is my favorite topic, and this is our lecture number 16. So let's start from here. So before, as the name of this topic is indicating that this is the oxidative phosphorylation. So the name indicated that there is somewhat oxidation and the phosphorylation that would be taking place during a biological reaction, and the as the electron transport chain is the name is implies, so it is indicating that there must be a chain of electron that would be doing so in this in any biological process that we are going to discuss. So to study, to understand about what is oxidative phosphorylation and what is electron transport chain, first we have to understand that what is cellular respiration. So actually cellular respiration is a process of synthesizing ATP by our body cells. So whenever our body cell synthesizes ATP, we say that our cell is respiring. This cell is producing energy in the form of ATP. So in our body there are three main metabolic pathways that take place in our body cell that produce the major amount of energy in the form of ATP. So these pathways are glycolysis, citric acid cycle, or electron transport chain. Although other pathways in our body also produce energy, for example fatty acid oxidation, but here we are talking about three major pathways that produce energy in our body cell, that is glycolysis, Krebs cycle, and electron transport chain finally. So because these pathways have connection with our topic, so we would be studying that what is the electron transport chain, what is the oxidative phosphorylation, and what are the connections of the glycolysis, Krebs cycle with this electron transport chain and oxidative phosphorylation. So to understand about what is electron transport chain, first we have to understand that how cell respires, how cell produces ATP in our body. So this is the picture of a cell. Just we have to assume that this is a picture of a cell. So this is the cell cytosol, and it is the mitochondria. And mitochondria, as you know, having three compartment. One is the mitochondrial matrix, and then two compartment. One is the mitochondrial membrane and mitochondrial matrix, and one is the intermembrane space. And the mitochondrial matrix and intermembrane space is separated by one inner mitochondrial membrane. So this is the picture of four mitochondria that is present in the cytosol. So why we are discussing the compartment of the mitochondria, because it is very much important to understand about the mitochondria compartment to understand the electron transport chain. We will be studying it in few seconds. So first of all, we have to study about, understand about how and from where this is of ATP synthesized in our cell. So first pathway during that the ATP synthesized in our body is the glycolysis, or in our cell is the glycolysis. So glycolysis oxidizes glucose into pyruvate. So then pyruvate decarboxylates and converts into acetyl CoA. This acetyl CoA enters in the mitochondrial matrix. So the mitochondrial matrix, this acetyl CoA enters into the Krebs cycle, that is also known as the TCA cycle or the citric acid cycle. So this acetyl CoA needs to go through different series of a different chemical reaction in the Krebs cycle and form NADH and FADH2. So actually all together with the formation of ATP, energy in the form of ATP. So we are concerned about here in this TCA cycle, the production of NADH and FADH2, because this NADH and FADH2 are the precursors that synthesize or that utilize to produce energy during the oxidative phosphorylation or during the electron transport chain. So what happened there after the entrance of this acetyl CoA into the Krebs cycle, the NADH and FADH are produced, and this NADH and FADH enters in the electron transport chain. So how this enters into the electron transport chain and how these are involved for the production of energy via oxidative phosphorylation or via going through the electron transport chain, we will be seeing in our coming slides. But here we have to understand just that this NADH and FADH2 that are generated during the Krebs cycle, CCA cycle or citric acid cycle would enter in the electron transport chain. So to understand or oxidative phosphorylation, so to understand electron transport chain or oxidative phosphorylation, we have to clear in our mind this idea that this inner membrane, mitochondrial membrane, is embedded with different complex proteins that we call as enzyme complex. So actually these are the enzyme complex, these are the enzyme proteins that are found to be embedded in the inner mitochondrial membrane that are involved in the production of energy, for the production of energy from the NADH and FADH2 via the process of oxidative phosphorylation or electron transport chain. So in this slide you will be seeing that how this oxidative phosphorylation or electron transport chain takes place. Actually the oxidative phosphorylation is consists on two steps. One is the electron transport chain and one is the chemiosmosis. So chemiosmosis actually the process in which you can say that charged particle or means chemical entities or means fast semi-permeable membrane from higher concentration to lower concentration. So in this case for the oxidative phosphorylation, this semi-permeable membrane is the enzyme complex that is ATP synthase. So this ATP synthase selectively transfer proton from the many number of charged particles that are present here. So this ATP synthase selectively transfer this proton from intermembrane space to inside the membrane and convert this ATP to ATP. So this process is called as chemiosmosis. We will be extensively studying this process in our coming slides. But you have to just remember in this slide or till here that oxidative phosphorylation is a process that is consists on a two steps. One is electron transport chain and one is chemiosmosis. I have already described that what is chemiosmosis, and now I'm going to describe what is electron transport chain. Electron transport chain actually a chain of the electron that are shuttling of the electron that are produced by NADH and FADH2. Okay, where the electron, NADH and FADH2 are produced during the Krebs cycle. This NADH and FADH2 generate electron. These electrons shuttle via different enzyme complex that are embedded inside the inner mitochondrial membrane, and then these electrons then finally pass on, finally utilized to pump these protons. Proton via the ATP synthase into the inner mitochondrial matrix and form ATP from ADP. So electron transport chain is actually a shuttling of electrons via different enzyme complexes and then finally utilized for the synthesis of energy via ATP synthase. So this is the electron transport chain, and the oxidative phosphorylation is a process in that the phosphorylation of ADP takes place, and what does as the name is indicated, that oxidative phosphorylation means there are some different oxidation reaction and phosphorylation reaction. So the oxidative phosphorylation is consists on two steps. One is electron transport and one is chain osmosis. And then I have the actually define you what is electron transport chain. We will be extensively studying this electron transport chain with its explanation of its component enzyme complex in my coming slide. But here we just have to understand that electron transport chain is a two-step process, is a process that is consists on two steps. Oxidative phosphorylation is a process that is consists on a two-step, and the electron transport chain is a coupling of the electron that are produced by NADH, FADH2, two different enzyme complexes, and finally involved in the production of energy. And from here, this NADH and FADH2 comes from the, came from these NADH and FADH2 came from the Krebs cycle. So, to understand this electron transport chain or oxidative phosphorylation, we have to understand first about what are the enzyme complexes that are found to be embedded in the inner mitochondrial membrane and involved in the shuttling of the electron and production of the energy. So, this is the picture of the inner mitochondrial membrane, and the, we can see here, this is the same picture that we will be having here. So we can see that this is the inner mitochondrial membrane, and here are the different enzyme complexes that are found to be embedded in this inner mitochondrial membrane. And if the enzyme complexes are involved in the shuttling of electron transport chain through electron transport chain, and the production of energy via oxidative phosphorylation. So first of all, we have to understand what are these complexes. So actually, the complexes that are involved in electron transport chain, these are all together five complexes. And complex one is actually an enzyme. Although all these five complexes are enzymes. So for the electron transport chain, five complexes work together. And they also, with these five enzymes, two small molecules, that is coenzyme Q and cytochrome C, also work with them. So, complex 1 is an enzyme that is NADPH dehydrogenase. So, as the name dehydrogenase indicates, dehydrogenase are the enzymes that remove hydrogen from our substrate. So, this complex 1 is NADPH dehydrogenase. Complex 2 is the succinate dehydrogenase. So succinate dehydrogenase, as the name of the enzyme dehydrogenase indicates, that here it will be involved in the removal of a hydrogen from a substrate. So we will be studying what from what substrate complex 2 remove hydrogen in our later slide, but here we just have to understand this complex 2 is succinate dehydrogenase. So complex 3 is a cytochrome B, and complex 4 is cytochrome A, and complex 5 is a selective enzyme complex that we say as ATP synthase. Why this we say this ATP synthase? Because it is involved in the production of the energy in the from the synthase is an enzyme that combines two substrates and form a one product. So actually this synthase enzyme here combines ADP plus phosphate group and form ATP. So that is why we call it ATP synthase. So in the electron transport chain and oxidative phosphorylation, all these five enzymes and two proteins work together and produce energy from NADH and FADH2. So here we are, this is the whole mechanism of the production of energy from NADH and FADH2, or the precursor NADH and FADH2, or the electron and proton that are generated from NADH and FADH2. So here we see that how this mechanism takes place in the inner mitochondrial membrane. So what happened when in the mitochondrial matrix, TCA cycle generate NADH and FADH2. So as we can see here, I will go again on this slide. So NADH, this is the NADH and FADH2. So this two molecules generate in via the Krebs cycle in the mitochondrial matrix. So after generation of these two molecules in the mitochondrial matrix, what happens next? When this NADH comes into contact with complex 1 that is embedded inside inner mitochondrial membrane. So what will happen as this enzyme is NADH dehydrogenase? So it will remove a proton or a hydrogen from a substrate that is NADH. So this enzyme complex 1 remove a hydrogen from this NADH and convert it into NAD. So here we can see a hydrogen or a proton is removed from NADH. And what happened? This NADH is also having electron together with proton. So the proton removed from complex 1, however, and stays for a while in inner mitochondrial membrane. However, this electron will pass, deliver to complex 1. So what will happen? The electron is having the energy in the form of a charge, so this complex 1 would be charged. So what happened when this complex 1 enzyme would be charged, and here with the higher concentration or a lot of proton that would be synthesized after conversion of NADH into NAD via this complex 1. So what will happen, this electron that has been charged, this complex 1, pumps out this proton from mitochondrial matrix to intermembrane state, okay, and then after doing this work, these electrons would transfer from complex 1 to coenzyme Q, and then this is the work of complex 1, and then what happened next, FADH2 that synthesized during Krebs cycle will come into contact with complex 2 that is succinate dehydrogenase. As the name of enzyme dehydrogenase indicated, it also removes a hydrogen from FADH2, so it converts FADH2 into FAD, and proton will release in mitochondrial matrix. However, electron that this FADH2 is having will be passed on to complex 2. So this complex 2, what does this complex 2 pass on this electron to coenzyme Q? Now coenzyme Q is having more electron as compared to now coenzyme Q, what does it do? It is having electron from both complex 1 and complex 2. So this coenzyme Q shuttle these electrons that it is having from the complex 1 and complex 2 into complex 3. So complex 3 will get all the electrons from complex 2, and as it is having more electrons as compared to complex 1, so it pumps, it gets charged, and more charged, even more charged than complex 1. And then this complex 3 after getting charged, it pumps out more protons from in mitochondrial matrix to the intermembrane state. And then after pumps out this proton into intermembrane state, these electrons that complex 3 is having transport to cytochrome C, and then cytochrome C transport this electron to complex 4. So again complex 4 gets charged, but it would be less charged than complex 1 and complex 3. And then it after getting charged, the complex 4 also pumps out proton from mitochondrial matrix to intermembrane state. So what happens then after transportation of electron, what happened then? These electron then reaches transfer to the mitochondrial matrix, where this electron that shuttles from complex 1 to complex 4, after pumping out this proton and charging the complex all these complexes, the electron finally reaches back to the mitochondrial matrix, where these electrons combine with the proton, and then these electron and proton combine with the oxygen, half molecule of oxygen, and convert into water. However, what happens after this shuttling of the electron and the charging of these complexes and the pumping out of this proton from a mitochondrial matrix to intermembrane space, the concentration of the proton ion, that is the positive ion, will get increased in the intermembrane space as compared to the inner mitochondrial matrix, as compared to the mitochondrial matrix. So what happened then? What happened then? A charge gradient would be established between two compartments. That is, one is the mitochondrial matrix and the intermembrane space. So as you know, charge particles always move from the higher concentration to the lower concentration via a selective permeable membrane. So in this case, this complex 5, that is ATP synthase, it will act as a semi-permeable membrane or selective filter. So it selectively transfers this proton from intermembrane space to the mitochondrial matrix. So what will happen then, when this proton will reach from intermembrane space to the mitochondrial matrix, in mitochondrial matrix, these proton would be utilized to combine phosphate group with ATP. So when the phosphate group is combined with ATP with the help of this enzyme, so this is the process of phosphorylation. And then what happened, this ATP after ADP after combination with or after combining with a phosphate group convert into the ATP, that is high energy molecule. So this process is called as phosphorylation. So and then this is the phosphorylation, and then where the oxidation takes place in whole this process, when these enzyme complex, as they are dehydrogenases, that remove hydrogen from the substrate and during the oxidation. So these are the oxidative processes or oxidative reactions that are taking place in complex 1 and complex 2. So the why we are saying this cycle, this is the oxidative phosphorylation, because in this cycle ATP is producing or phosphorylation is taking place due to the oxidation of NADH and FADH3. So a process in that oxidation is involved for the phosphorylation. So the process is called as oxidative phosphorylation. So this was about the whole electron transport chain. I hope you understand it. So the electron transport chain is having importance in our body because it is involved in the production of energy or high energy molecule, that is ATP. So one more thing that we have to understand here, that although various processes, metabolic processes take place in our body that produces energy, for example, glycolysis produces energy. That is how I use this picture here to show you that what pathway produces what amount of energy. Although various pathways take place in our body that produce energy in the form of ATP, like the glycolysis, like the Krebs cycle, or the electron transport chain. But the energy or ATP that is produced in the electron transport chain is much higher as compared to the all these pathways, for example, Krebs cycle or glycolysis or other pathways that take place in our body. So now this is the importance of electron transport chain, that it produces, or oxidative phosphorylation, that it produces a higher amount of energy or one of the most significant amount of energy in our body as compared to the other pathways. Or this energy is produced in the form of ATP via the oxidation of NADH and FADH2. So this was the importance of electron transport chain, whole the mechanism of electron transport chain and enzyme complexes that are involved for the in the electron transport chain or oxidative phosphorylation. But this process is also having a drawback in our body, as during the oxidative processes of this oxidative phosphorylation, for example, the conversion of NADH into NADH to NADH, NADH to NAD, and FADH to FAD, free radical generated in our mitochondrial matrix, and these free radicals are in the form of superoxide and ion. So the superoxide and ion is one of the most potential means after the hydroxyl group. It is one of the potential damaging free radical, because it is quickly convert into all other types of free radical in our body. And then what a free radical does in our body, the free radical oxidize different proteins in our body and interfere with the metabolic pathways in our body and leading various diseases. So how we counteract with these free radical, making us produce a system of defensive system in our body that we say as antioxidant enzymes. So these antioxidant enzymes are present in intermembrane space and in the mitochondrial matrix. So these antioxidant enzymes utilize these free radicals and convert these free radicals into water and protect us in the or protect cell in the deleterious effects of these free radicals. So we will see in this slide what are these antioxidant enzymes and what they are doing here. So in the intermembrane space, SOD1, superoxide dismutase is present. It is an antioxidant enzyme. It neutralizes or converts superoxide free radical into hydrogen peroxide. However, another enzyme, that is glutathione peroxidase, it neutralizes hydrogen peroxide into water. And then in the mitochondrial matrix, superoxide dismutase is present here, that converts superoxide into hydrogen peroxide, and then hydrogen peroxide could be converted into water by glutathione peroxidase. So these was the natural defensive system in our body to counteract this free radical. However, there are different drugs have been identified till now that can also inhibit different protein complex in oxidative phosphorylation or electron transport chain, and can protect cells from deleterious effects of this free radical. So these are the identified molecule or drug that are the inhibitor or inhibitor of oxidative phosphorylation. So one is the rotenone, that inhibit complex 1, and malonate is an inhibitor of complex 2, and actinomycin is an inhibitor of complex 3, and cyanide is the inhibitor of complex 4. However, oligomycin is the inhibitor of complex 5. So these are all the molecules that can be utilized from outside of our body to inhibit the oxidative phosphorylation or to protect us from the deleterious effect of free radicals that are synthesized from during oxidative phosphorylation or electron transport chain. So I hope you understand about this whole lecture that was about electron transport chain or oxidative phosphorylation. So I also wish to conclude what is the electron transport chain and what is the oxidative phosphorylation. Actually, the oxidative phosphorylation is a process in that our cell, body cell, is synthesized ATP after the phosphorylation from the precursor of Krebs cycle, NADH and FADH oxidation. And this process consists on two steps. One is electron transport chain, and one is chemiosmosis. And what is the oxidative electron transport chain? Electron transport chain is a coupling of the electron from different enzyme complexes and then formation of the ATP. So this was all about the electron transport chain and the oxidative phosphorylation. I hope you have understand. it and like this lecture. Thank you very much for your understanding. And if you wish to understand more about this topic, I have placed different links here, and these links are provided in my lecture. So kindly go through this link for your more understanding. I hope you understand all the lecture, and thank you very much in the last.